This module will cover yet another way that muscle force is modulated, and that is through the force-length relationship. This is, I believe, one of the most applicable muscle mechanics relationships that you can use because it holds true on the sarcomere level, so on the cellular level, all the way to the human body. We use force-length relationship when we're deciding on exercises to train different parts of the muscle. This image illustrates the force-length relationship at the sarcomere level. So along the x-axis, we have sarcomere length in micrometer, and along the y-axis, we have force. And as we see it, shorter sarcomere length, the force is lower. It increases up to C, which is a mid-range, 2 to 2.5 sarcomere length. And then at longer length, the force decreases. So let's answer these questions. Number one, is the force at A greater than C? No, it's not. C, which is mid-range sarcomere length, is the max force production of that sarcomere. So this relationship is like an inverted U. Max at the middle, less force when at shorter length, less force at longer length. So number two, is the force at D equal to the force at A? It is. Generally speaking, if you put a line through D and A, a horizontal line, the force at A is about the same level as the force at region D. However, number three asks, is the sarcomere length equal at D and A? And that's no. So basically, it's illustrating that at short sarcomere length, you generate less force, and at longer sarcomere length, you generate less force. And the key is to explain why that occurs. So here is the same relationship between sarcomere length and force, or sometimes referred to as tension. And this is the slide that will let you explain why in the mid-range sarcomere length, the force is maximized and the force is less at shorter lengths and longer lengths. And it goes back to what we stated in the sarcomere module, was that force production is directly proportional to the crossbridge number. Okay, and so if we look at the actin and myosin sites that are available to attach, more sites are available mid-range in the sarcomere length. Okay, so that's the top image at the top of that inverted U. When you squish that sarcomere together, your actin filaments are overlapping, and that's decreasing the number of sites for sarcomere or for crossbridge attachment. So you would have less crossbridges attached. Less crossbridges means less force production. So your force is lower when the sarcomere is at shorter length. On the other side of the graph, when the sarcomere length is stretched out, again, the actin filaments are pulled away from the myosin filaments, and there's less crossbridge site attachment available. If you have less crossbridge number, you have less force produced, and so you have a lower force at long sarcomere length. So when you're too short, it's not optimal, less force produced. When it's too long, the sarcomere is too long, less force is produced, and right in the middle is just right. This force-length relationship at the sarcomere level actually holds true at the muscle level in the human body. And at that point, we call it the torque angle relationship, because as you move your joint through different angles from here, from elbow extension to elbow flexion, the muscle length changes length and thus changes its force production capabilities and then results in more or less torque generation at the joint. Okay, so at a fully extended, if we look at our biceps brachii model, it's a lengthened muscle. When you're slightly flexed at the elbow joint, you're in mid position, and shortened when you're in full elbow flexion. And then you just need to think about what the sarcomeres do at each of these. The lengthened muscles, the sarcomeres will be pulled apart, jittering less force. Mid-range, the cross-bridge numbers will be optimized. And when you shorten that muscle belly, you're squishing those sarcomeres within that muscle, less cross-bridge sites available and less force production available. So here is a graph illustrating just what we discussed in the last slide. Along the x-axis is the elbow angle from flexion to extension, and along the y-axis is the torque production. And remember, torque is equal to force times moment arm. And so as torque changes, you assume the force is changing as well. So mid-range elbow angles is the max torque. When you get to full extension of the elbow angle, you decrease that torque production. And when you are at full flexion, you decrease that torque production. So the torque elbow angle relationship is just like the sarcomere length force relationship, and it's an inverted U. Mid-ranges, you can generate more torque. And at the extremes, when your muscles are shortened or excessively lengthened, you can generate less torque. However, at some joints, as you increase the joint angle, or so go into more extension where your muscles are at longer length, the force is maintained at a certain level. And so how can that occur? If the sarcomere is lengthened and there's less cross bridges, so the force should drop off, why in some cases is force maintained? And the next graph will illustrate the reason why. This graph merges what happens at the sarcomere level, or at the active contractile component, which is in green, with what happens with the passive components. So all the mesiums and the titin that we learned in modules previously. And so from a certain position, that as you lengthen the muscle, there is an increase in that passive tension. And that's the tension that you would feel if you started to do a stretch to lengthen your hamstring muscle. You feel that passive tension when you're stretching. That is due to all your mesiums. The active portion of the force length curve is due to the sarcomeres and the number of cross bridges. But you see at longer length, even though the sarcomere force production is dropping off, there is an increase in passive tension. Okay? And so the total tension in that muscle actually is maintained, as you can see in the blue curve, because even though the sarcomere cross bridges are decreasing, the passive or rubber band type tension in your muscle is increasing, and so you're maintaining some force. So this illustrates both the active contractile components and the SEC and the PEC components of the muscle working together.